snow.
Okay.
So there is a period when the teams are playing on a Saturday and a Sunday, when you, Christina, and any other female members would be able to go into the changing room when there's nobody in there, so you can view what's there and what isn't there. Thank you, Chair.
Right, okay. Sorry, but we've had a proposal for now that's been slightly amended by Councillor Lewis. Can we have a second or not? Okay, thank you. So the proposal is that we have a report brought back by the development officer, but also that we have those community members that want a site visit will be arranged for that to happen, and we'll go around a few of the pavilions. Okay? Are you agreed on that? Okay, thank you. And now on to agenda item 5, notice of motion, fair votes. Councillor, clearly down.
Just for protection, Councillor Berry, you did not take part or vote on that issue.
Well, don't you hurt him.
You are being watched.
That was really cool.
It was all agreed.
We didn't say it was all agreed except Bruce, so protect Bruce, we should really have had a show.
We must do.
I'm taking your abstaining.
We have a chair of that.
I'm abstaining.
It's just not there.
That's all the forms, thanks. Councillor Clary.
I'll make him for you then.
And Chair, any members, well, I'm familiar with this one. Yeah, thanks Chair. I trust members have read the motion, and I hope that it speaks for itself really in terms of highlighting the manifestly unfair allocation of seats in the recent general election. So once again, our outdated voting system is shown to be unfit for purpose for a population that is more diverse, better educated, and far less tribal than in the past. But while it's easy to identify the failings of the first past the post system, the broader consequences for society are less well understood. So I'm just going to briefly highlight some of those consequences. All of these are supported by relevant academic reports. So the first point would be that more people vote under proportional representation systems. Turnout for PR elections is typically 5 to 8% higher than under first past the post. This is hardly surprising, as the wasted vote syndrome, synonymous with first past the post, is a huge disincentive to vote. At the last local elections here in Wirral, the turnout was only 35%. In Scotland, for example, where the single transferable vote system has been in operation for local elections for the last decade, turnout is 12% higher than in Wirral. Secondly, PR voting systems which encourage consensual decision-making tend to reduce income inequalities. If we look at the 35 OECD countries, the only three that use first past the post, that's Canada, the UK and the USA, they all rank poorly on the income inequality index. The UK ranks 29th out of the 35. Thirdly, first past the post is the world's worst electoral system for gender balance in politics. The share of women in our parliament is only 32%, and it falls way short of countries with proportional voting systems. Every country in the world with more than 40% female MPs uses a form of PR. Across England, only 33% of councillors and 17% of council leaders are female. Fourthly, first past the post is bad for the environment. Studies have found that countries using proportional voting systems have higher environmental standards and scored on average 6 points more on the Yale Index, which measures a range of environmental outcomes. Also, first past the post encourages conflict. Military expenditure is consistently higher for countries using first past the post, and almost twice as high as for countries with fully proportional voting systems. Furthermore, countries with PR tend to have significantly less involvement in armed conflict. PR countries require broader consensus before being led into conflict by the executive. And finally, Chair, under First Past the Post, elections are determined by a small number of swing voters in a few marginal seats. Financial resources are targeted at such voters, which means money talks far more loudly in our disproportionate system than under PR. Now, there's also a few common myths about First Past the Post which I'd like to address. Firstly, it's promoted as leading to stable government. In fact, we have averaged one unplanned election every 10 years over the last century. Countries with First Past the Post have elections slightly more frequently than those with PR. Secondly, it's entirely possible to retain a constituency link under PR. The Electoral Reform Society, for example, recommends larger constituencies electing 4 to 6 MPs under a single transferable vote system. So in that case, Wirral would have a single constituency returning 4 MPs. Thirdly, the AV referendum vote in 2011 was not a referendum on proportional representation. AV is not proportional and produces similarly perverse outcomes as First Past the Post. In fact, opinion polls consistently show overwhelming public support for a voting system where seats match votes. So, councillors, First Past the Post is way past its sell-by date. It is a dead weight stifling our democracy. As the excellent Labour Campaign for Electoral Reform report into PR puts it, it is no exaggeration to say that proportional representation is a prerequisite for a properly functioning democracy in which power, wealth and opportunity are in the hands of the many and not the few. So I hope you agree with that and I urge you to support the vote.
That's what I said.
Just a quick comment, really. I mean, a lot of the arguments sound more like correlation than causation, but it seems to be that PR is the cure for everything. So, I actually support PR, so that might be one of the novel ones on my side, but I think proportional representation, people's votes counting, and becoming part of democracy is what, you know, is what it's all about. So, yeah, I would be supporting.
Steve and then Max Holden.
I won't be supporting the motion. I think it's basically national politicking using the vehicle of notice of motion, which I'm not very far off, you may guess, mechanism. And it mentions quite clearly this is the aim of the Green Party, and for forwarding the aims of the Green Party, it's mentioned that that's the only party that, in his view, seems to benefit. And I think it's a bit messy, actually, the fact that you've had to collude with another political party to get it on the table. And I wasn't going to mention this, and I did discuss it earlier, but I'm going to mention, but you mentioned the issue that PR has led to a disproportionate lack of females, I think you said, in Parliament and other systems. Yet, the two parties who are moving and seconding this do not have a female councillor amongst them. And I'll set the challenge to you.
It will.
And I'll set the challenge. I'll set the challenge to you. Get your own house in order before you come to committees telling us how to do things and all things. Why don't you do something positive and I'll lay the challenge to your leader and I'd like to on this matter. The next your two safest seats, Oxford and Eastern, okay, where you have sitting councillors. Next time you serve the candidate, you introduce an all-female choice. That would at least guarantee or give you a good chance of having a female councillor amongst the groups that are lecturing us on there not being PR would create more women in Parliament. I've never been a fan of PR, and how could I be? Because I'm elected here by a system that's first past the post. That's what got me here. And to say that wasn't the correct way for me to be elected would be I'd be hypocritical to myself. My view is that this is a wrong use of the notice of motion. There has been a debate around it nationally. 68%, I think, said they didn't want to engage in that first class vote. And to quote the Ulster Unionists propping up to Conservative government, well, the Dems propped up the Tory government the last time around. If you go to Italy and places like that, where they have numerous political parties, there are deals done under PR as well, and there are deals done trespass opposed. I don't see that as a requisite. My view is it's a system that British people have voted on and would like to keep.
Thank you, Chair. And thanks for the notice of motion, Pat. It brings to the fore a burning issue in this country, and I think the vast majority of what you said was correct in my opinion. I think first past the post is well updated. And whether this is a proper committee for this motion or not, it's before this committee now. I was elected on the first past the post as well, but that doesn't make it correct. And that also doesn't make me hypocritical for supporting Pat's notice of motion. It is outdated. It is undemocratic. It leads to bad government. And we've seen that with a huge majority that the Conservatives had under Margaret Thatcher. And that, dare I say, it also highlights the huge majorities Tony Blair got.
Yeah.
And what happened with that Labour government.
Yeah.
So there's two illustrations of first past the post, because huge majority governments are not good for democracy and they're not good for the country. PR would lead to better government and coalitions, and I'm not going to mention coalitions by name, but there's nothing wrong with coalition government. It produces better government, and that's what we're after, and that's what this notice of motion is bringing to the fore. What we want in this country is better government from all the parties, and PR would help, and I for one will be supporting this notice of motion. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chair. Paul said, Mike, that was really, I'm really troubled in what you said. It's quite nice to see the difference in being attacked on one side and then having an answer on the other.
Shouldn't be party politics.
No, it shouldn't, and neither of this committee, to be honest. But I just wanted to make a couple of points in answer to Steve's questions. Of not having a female councillor on the world. I think we've just had one who was a mayoress, and she's been on the council for how long?
Okay, I'll write you a
note
there,
as a step.
So, with regard to first past the post, I agree with you totally, and I will be supporting it.
You did have a female. What are you about to get a female?
Right. Any more comments, Ian?
Yes, clearly, this committee's ability to change the voting system is probably the end. But in fact, it has been referred to this committee. Again, it was a notice of motion, a valid notice of motion. Decided it was valid by the head of the law at the time, and it's come before this committee, the third by the mayor. I would say that the reason why the two examples that Mike gave, that he feels are such bad examples, the Conservative government in the 80s and the surprisingly Labour government in the 1990s and 2000s, both were elected by big majorities, not because of the voting system, but because of the weak opposition faced by them at both times. So it was the Labour Party's fault in the 80s and the Conservative Party's fault in the 90s that led to Thatcher and Blair, respectively. It wasn't the voting system around that time. And I have to say, I have to say, sitting on this side of the committee tonight and the last couple of meetings of various committees, I have to say the biggest coalition that I see is the Labour Group. That's the biggest coalition in the past at the moment.
Okay, we have to take any more comments.
Well, just a couple of points. I mean, if both those governments have been referred to, neither of them were elected with a majority of the electorate. They got a majority of seats, but they never got more than 50% of the vote. So that's a point I'd make. I mean, I think the point about female representation is a really important one, and I think the comments we've heard are really unfortunate. We've got a problem with not enough women in politics, and to kind of trivialise it, as has been done, I think is really unfortunate. It is a big deal, and I think all of the political parties recognise that, and they take various steps internally to try and deal with it. And you know, I'm quite a fan of all the English shortlists and that kind of thing. I think it does help. But I mean, fundamentally, it's just easier for marginalised groups, including ethnic minorities, to get elected under a fair voting system. They get squeezed out by an unfair voting system. So if we want to kind of increase the number of women, if we want to increase the number of ethnic minorities in councils, in government, we need a fair voting system, and that's just a basic item of fairness. And, you know, Mike summed up very, very well in our shortlist comments, and I hope members will listen to their support. Thank you.
Okay. Any other hands? All those in favour of this motion?
Myself and Ken Smith from Department of Health, a colleague, Victoria Chatterton, who is involved in the measurement of air quality on the road, is here to answer questions as well. So, presentation, as we've done before, if you want to ask questions during the presentation, please do so. On the way to the end, we go to discussion at the end of our presentation as well. So, what we're going to cover briefly is I'm going to give you a strategic overview of air quality. It's a timely topical issue. You'll be aware that the government launched their plan in July. I'm going to give you some details about that. And we want to explain how rural measures air quality, what we do, who we report to, etc. We want to give you an update on what is happening across the city region. And things are changing and happening in that respect, and our position on across the region. I mentioned the government's plan. We're going to give you details about what that entails and what opportunity it gives us and access to funding, etc. And we'll then talk about opportunities and issues that relate to air quality moving forward. So in terms of strategic overview, there's quite a lot of bullet points, so you can see them there. We'll just go through them. As I said, the government launched its plan for improving air quality in the UK in July. It was a culmination of a considerable period of consultation and legal challenge, but nonetheless, it's out. The plan includes a headline, as you're sure, for the summer of ending the sale of diesel and petrol cars by 2040. That was the headline long-term objective. However, there's a range of short and medium-term objectives on addressing the most polluted locations in the UK. The government requires local authorities to take action to establish what are called clean air zones or CASs in such locations. I have to say that doesn't apply to anywhere in Merseyside, as you'll hear. Across the region, there are 11 declared air quality management areas for locations that will exceed or likely to exceed legal levels for nitrogen dioxide levels. And there are 543 of these so-called areas in the UK, in England. Again, I'll stress none are in rural. We have not had to declare such an area for our authority. Local authorities are required by statute to explain how that works to you in more detail to measure assess air quality. Therefore, rural has an established measuring arrangement, which again will explain the resources we have for that. We report air quality measures on an annual basis to DEFRA, and they review our submission and give us comments. And historically, we've always received positive feedback in terms of our structure, the adequacy of it, and the measurements being below threshold. So before we go on to how we measure air quality, just a quick overview of what our main priorities. Air pollution is a mixture of particles and gases that have an effect on human health. The government has set statutory levels for 7 pollutants. The main two that concern us that we presented tonight are on particle matter and nitrogen dioxide as their most concern. Much of particulate matter in urban environments, as you'd expect, come from traffic sources. Transport is also a major contributor to nitrogen dioxide emissions, particularly from diesel-powered cars, light-duty vehicles such as cars and vans. It's interesting to note that in the years since 2000, the 16 years that have occurred, diesel cars have increased from 3.2 million to over 12 million in the UK. A statistic from Public Health England, using various amounts of modelling techniques, estimate that in rural, particulate matter contributes potentially to 166 approximately premature deaths per year. However, on rural, as you'll hear, a comparison between 2010 and 2015 is that basically nitrogen dioxide levels are diminishing. They are reducing here, and they are below the national threshold. In terms of the threshold, apologies that this is a slightly busy slide. This is taken from the submission we sent to DEFRA. These are the measurements of air pollution, and the first two are the key ones for us: nitrogen dioxide and particulate matter. There is an annual meeting, because we measure this on an ongoing basis, which again you'll hear from. Basically, the tolerance is there in terms of 40 micrograms per cubic metre of air, and that's what we measure against. The others are measured, or been measured in the past, but they are low and insignificant at the moment, so we don't measure them in the same way that we do for nitrogen dioxide and particulate matter. I'm going to hand over to my colleague.
Through you, Chair. What I want to do now is to go through rural's air quality monitoring arrangements. As Mike has explained to us, all local authorities have a duty to review air quality in their area every year. And as Mike has mentioned, we produce an air quality and an annual status review, it's called. We submit that to DEFRA, and they look at it, see if it's robust and appropriate. Fit for purpose. The current annual status review, and of interest for last year, is still with DEFRA. They are looking at it, and the preliminary information we have is they're satisfied with it. Once hopefully they've approved it, it will be circulated. Councils must declare air quality management areas and reduce plans where the levels that we measure exceed the statutory limits. Currently, just to echo what Mike said, we don't have any air quality management areas on Wirral. We'll have a look at some of the results in a moment. So how do we measure air quality, and what are we measuring and looking for? We're looking at nitrogen oxides, pollution nitrogen dioxide. Now this is a pollutant that White is associated with vehicles and transport. Probably about 80% of it comes from transport. This is the pollutant that the government is most worried about. Overall in the UK it's been trending down, but we've got some hotspots in the country that the government is very concerned about. We measure nitrogen oxides by using some quite old-fashioned technology called diffusion tubes. If you're very observant as you're driving around, you might spot that they are almost like test tubes that are secured to lampposts or the fronts of houses that we put up every month. Then a month later we go, we collect them, we send them off to the lab. They tell us by looking at the material within them what the concentration of nitrogen in oxides is likely to be in that area. We have 21 of these spread throughout the borough, and they are mainly targeted at traffic hotspots. So we've spoken to colleagues in transport, and historically that's where we've put them, looking where we think the problem is going to be worse. As well as those, we have two air quality monitoring stations that are run by the government, by DEFRA within the borough. And they monitor air quality in real time. They are located in Victoria Park in Tranmere, and also there's a smaller unit on Borough Road. And they look at a slightly wider variety of things. The one in Victoria Park looks at ozone and particulate nitrogen oxides. So where are our main issues? We will have a little graph in a moment, but the main air quality hotspots, if you like, areas that have a higher level of nitrogen oxides, are Singleton Road, in this area of Singleton Road, Harrow Park, the A41 and Port Sunlight area, and there's also some Air Quality Road in this lot, which I'll come on to in a moment.
So, can you just tell us where Singleton Road is?
Singleton Avenue. Do apologise.
But can I just say that they're all busy roads, so it's very plain that they'll be hotspots, because all of them out parks, whereabouts our park by the Arrow Park Hotel, is desperately busy, and with Arrow Park, it's a junction there where a lot of roads converge, and we put traffic, dare I say, we've put traffic lights up
which stop the traffic idling engines pumping out pollutants. So the council decisions are influencing the 166 deaths that we have, and there's 40,000, over 40,000 deaths in this country. So this is probably, if this is probably the most important agenda item for the Environment Committee, dare I say.
Thank you for that, and thank you, Chair. Certainly, there are no real surprises. There's a couple of things that I'll talk about in a moment, but where we see high volumes of traffic that's stationary for longer periods of time, we would expect quite a higher level of absolutely. And some of the measures that we're thinking about taking as well might address some of that, some of those concerns about idling. The latest measurements that we have overall show that the levels are going down nationally. I think 5-year period between 2010-2015 was a 17% decrease in levels of nitrogen oxides. But in small localised areas, there are still problems throughout the country, and it's important that we carry on monitoring to make sure that they are not on the rise. I mentioned one road that I wanted to speak on a little bit more. In 2016, one site exceeded the national air quality objective threshold, and that was Wallasey Road in Liscard. This was following complaints about idling taxis at a taxi rank, whilst it didn't fit in with the objectives of measuring the house facades or schools or hospitals. We've carried out monitoring there to see if that is a particular problem. And again, it's probably not surprising that due to perhaps idling on the taxi rank, those are elevated levels. I'll have to talk a little bit more later on about what we're trying to do to address that. Because there aren't residences there, that hasn't been regarded as relevant exposure, so we've not been asked to put an air quality management area in place at that location. Council has established an air quality liaison group, and that is where officers from planning, traffic and transportation, sustainability, environmental health and public health meet together to look at air quality, and as time goes on, to give more scrutiny to this annual review, to make sure that we're looking at the right places, we're not missing anything, and we're behaving properly.
Can I ask a question whether that's able to know you? You've got a school there. Do you have to do anything different? We've got a school with a playground that is almost onto Singleton Avenue. I'm presuming that you're talking more about where Singleton Avenue is for a road, because then you get by there, but even so, is that taken into account?
Thank you for the future. The Singleton Avenue area, they are, as we'll see, I'll come on to a graph, a chart in a moment. It doesn't breach the level of 40 micrograms that we use on average. However, it is something that this air quality group is looking at, what we can do with colleagues in transportation, with maybe working with the public more to see what we can do to improve the air quality, and also try and make sure that people aren't exposed to more air. More pollution than they need to be. If that makes sense, sorry, does that answer the question? So,
no, yes. The question is where you've got this pollution and you've got things like primary schools.
Yes.
Does that, whatever the word is you use, to act faster, would that inspire you? I don't know, there's some stupid word.
The thing to note is, of the 21 sites, historically, one site, which you mentioned there, has got above the threshold. Every other measurement, including the Singleton Avenue, is below the legal threshold.
Yeah, Yeah, I'm quite aware that they've said that. If you put four up, and I'm asking about one of them, because it's got a school near it. One is A41, presumably, is at the end of the bypass, there's no school there. Arrow Park, I don't think there's a school there. And as I understand it, children are just acceptable.
Sorry, Chris.
There's not a school on that roundabout.
We've got a, Chris, I was going to interject, we've got a hospital.
Exactly. No, so the point I'm making is that the susceptibility of small children, and as they will be outside in it when they're in the yard, that's why I'm asking about it.
Sorry, can I just add what Christina said? I mean, probably the worst school in the whole authority is St. Albans in this car.
Yeah.
Because the playground is almost on the road, and you know, quite often not being there, I always think, oh my goodness, it must be really polluted there, because there's cars constantly going round there, stopping, and buses, everything really. And so, you know, there must be something, the children, and I know they put up some barriers, but they're not great barriers there. But I wonder if someone would possibly look at that and then come back.
You know, we talk about the threshold, to set the threshold, do you know, somebody sets this threshold level. Is it a straight threshold level right across the board, as well as the different levels? If the areas like Christine and Michael are talking about, if it's by a school, there's a threshold lower than if it's on the main road like the A41, or is it just the same threshold level right across?
Okay, through you, Chair, there's a few questions there. I'll try and address them all. If I've missed one, please don't come back to me. First of all, there is one level, annual average level. There are also hourly levels, you know, but the results that we have don't indicate at the moment that those more harmful hourly levels will be reached. So there is one level. What about St. Albans? Interestingly, we've started to do some pilots with our colleagues in public health pilot studies to see whether we can engage with children and do some measurements, talk to children who will influence parents, you know, where you think the pollution is going to be worse, shall we use this? We've done some work in Liverpool John Lewis, gone and done some sort of measurements and walked around. There is a significant fall off away from the actual roads. Surprisingly, that study didn't, in that instance, find a significant problem, but that's not something that we are complacent about. The air quality group is looking at how we can talk to and work with schools. Are there better routes to school that avoid air pollution? Meanwhile, what can we do? It's a national problem, some of it are things we can influence locally, and we'll come on to the things that we all as a council are trying to do to tackle some of these issues. But we are looking at how to engage, for example, with schools like that. Coincidentally, St. Albans was one where we have done a pilot, and that is still ongoing. I'm sure there was another point, and I've probably not asked the old chair.
Okay, can I just ask, it says in the second bullet point that you'll monitor carefully to ensure that any organic salt is identified and acted upon.
Yep.
Could you give an example of how or what one is it that you would be doing to act upon if that trend occurs?
Right, okay. Thank you.
Can I just make a point to you as well? Is it not true that the national figures now show that children who are more exposed to the emissions are less likely to reach their potential? And that's one of the reasons why I'm asking over at school.
Thank you for your chair. If I take two of those, if you want to address those questions in order. First of all, as far as looking at trends, we review the figures we get in on a monthly basis to see how we performed last year. So we do continually monitor. What can we do if there is an issue and the air quality level is breached, there's only so much that we can do. Legally, if that breach we would have to declare an air quality management area, we would have to report it, bring it to members, and we would have to, would be especially required to put an action plan that would involve consultation with air quality public health, in traffic and transportation. And considering some of the things that we are going to be talking about sort of later, with, you know, ultimately, FEMA is actually a very severe, if you like, remedies that we're only allowed to use if we've tried everything else. If we've tried to look at how we tackle idling engines, traffic flow, influencing people's behaviour, using public transport, lowering the number of car journeys, those are the sorts of tools that are available to us.
This is another issue which is really uncomfortable for the council. The same as every other council. Because of diminishing budgets, you know, the cuts that we're experiencing, and it needs radical solution. And I think, you know, I'm fed up with hearing, you know, the cuts, and they are savage, and they are affecting us all. But it's like road safety. As a council, we spent a lot of money putting road pumps in, speed bumps, slows cars down, adds to pollution.
Yeah.
We spent a lot of money. In our park is a classic. It was a roundabout. Now, years ago, we spent a lot of money taking away the roundabouts, putting traffic lights in, cost a fortune. Now, if we're going to handle air pollution seriously as a council, we've got to look at these things, and we've now got, years ago when we took away the roundabouts and we put the traffic lights in, we didn't have the technology then to tell us, as stark as it is now, how bad the air quality is and how many people are dying. And we talked about, Christina's talked about the children, I mentioned the hospital. So as a council and as a committee, this committee, and it's the same with the committee I chair, we've got to look at how we can best tackle this. And if it means a committee making a recommendation to Cabinet that we need to put more money into certain departments if we're going to achieve the outcomes that we want, as uncomfortable as it is for Council, I think as committees, if we're going to do our job properly, and that goes for all the committees, we've got to make some difficult decisions. And if we're going to do scrutiny and do it properly, we've got to make, perhaps, I'm not prejudging here, but if we've got to make recommendations as committees, which makes some comfortable reading for Cabinet, I think we've got to look at it. You know, the bumps, when all this came out, we said, well, we've got to go around the country ripping up the bumps. But even if we've got to then make a case to central government that councils desperately, desperately need more money, we need to do it. Thank you.
Chair, just in total, we've got about four or five slides to get through here, so Kenny is obviously most one for everyone's
benefit. Well, you did say, Mike, if there's any questions,
just let's pick up here to ask questions. If you don't speak tonight, we might just want to go to the
room. I'm just saying
that. Thank officers and trainers what we're supposed to be doing.
Okay, just one more question from Adam Sykes and then we'll move on to the slides, please. Thanks, Chair, not to move into the debate. Just here's a question. You said earlier that you were looking at mean recordings, so obviously that's an average over time. There'll obviously be peaks. So do we do a rolling program of checking peak times to make sure that obviously the average is on exceeding level, but